Hey, what's up, garden friends?
Jeff here, Tropical Plant Party.
How's everybody doing?
I hope you're good. I am great.
Another Tuesday, another terrarium. Answer in the back, having a little bit of a soak. In the first video, I did one of these apothecary jars. I just kind of mocked it up, didn't plant it up because I broke it while I was filming it. I finished that in the video after, if you want to check that out. But in that video, I talked about some of the layers that are typical in the terrarium, specifically having the pumice and the charcoal, and then your soil or substrate, whatever you want to call it. Went over the various functions within all those different things, except for the soil. Soil gets really complicated. I've gone ahead and mixed up some soil over here. Remember, I use those air quotes. This is technically a soilless mix. It's peat, sand, some fine orchid bark in there, and there's a little bit of sphagnum. I picked a lot of it out because it looked like pretty low-grade sphagnum that's just going to deteriorate a little bit faster than I would prefer. I'm kind of a snob when it comes to using the sphagnum moss, and I'm trying to cut back on my peat use. So this is all based off of the repti soil, which you can find at most pet stores. It's made for terrariums and reptile enclosures. I like it because it's very clean, but it is peat based. So once I'm through with all that, I'm going to also try doing some terrariums that have a coconut fiber base, coconut core, because that's just a little bit more environmentally friendly. For now, I'm just using this standard peat-based mix. And it is pre-moistened, it's had some time to soak. I talked about in the last video about the importance of doing that. That way you don't have to water in these terrariums so incredibly heavily that it just becomes a nightmare trying to saturate the substrate layer without overfilling the reservoir on the bottom. So went ahead and did that beforehand. You have to let it soak for a long time. Peat will repel water when it's dry. I have tons and tons of different glass vessels that I want to do terrariums with. And while I don't want them to get redundant, the apothecary jars, that's what these are right here. I have its lid sitting elsewhere. But those are going to be all displayed together in my house. So I do kind of want them to go together. So I was thinking instead of doing like an apothecary jar every single week, I'd do one this week along with one of these other just like glass vase things, and then maybe to like bang them all out in a different video and then move on so things don't get too repetitive. I've got my pumice here, my activated horticultural charcoal. These are both the things talked about in the last video in more depth, at least, than I'm going to in this one. The pumice is actually pretty dusty too, so that would probably benefit from a rinse, but I don't really feel like it. It's just a little bit of dust. It's fine. No big deal. Go ahead and get a little layer of that down in the bottom. This is also when you would normally add a screen and then put your charcoal on top of the screen. Some more soil in here. Build this substrate layer up a little bit, and that's it. See? Really easy. I mean, I know there aren't any plants in there yet, but like getting these things going, it's not so hard. I mentioned the soil being clean, that repti soil being clean, mainly because one of the common things I get asked with these terrariums is usually about mold. Starting your terrariums off with a nice clean mix really does help a lot. That's why it usually is a soilless mix that's used in a terrarium and not something that's too heavy and like actual compost. Cleanliness is really the best bet for preventing molds and whatnot, but it's so hard to do that. I always make sure to clean these out before I use them, like right before I'm going to use them. So if they've been sitting around for a little while, I take them to the sink, put a little bit of dish soap in there, fill it up, let it soak for at least 10 minutes. Then I just dump it out, give it a little bit of a rinse. It's really easy, you know, just cleaning, not rocket science. But the reason I do that is because mold. Having these start off nice and clean and sterile is your best bet. But no matter what you do, mold spores are everywhere. So it just kind of happens. Just because you have mold in a terrarium doesn't mean like you're nasty or anything like that. It just sometimes it happens. But that is why I make sure to clean the vessel first to be safe. And then I don't like to mix up more soil than I'm going to use at a time. So that's why I mix it up in small batches. And then if there's anything remaining, make sure it's sealed very tightly. There are ways to sterilize soil. I think it's like 350 in the oven for like 10, 15 minutes. Look that up. Don't come blaming me if you burn your house down. Look it up just to be safe. I do know people have talked about microwaving their mixes. I think that that's a very risky idea. If there's anything metallic in there, sometimes, you know, there's sand in these and you don't know what's in them. That seems dangerous, but I know lots of people do it and swear by it, but I haven't done that. I have used the oven before. With a fresh bag that's sealed tightly, I don't really worry about it as much. And I'll talk more about handling mold should a mold issue arise with one of these. That'll be easier to talk about. And then if by the time I'm done with all these, which will be weeks away from now, no mold, then just talk about it then. If it does happen, take the lid off, let it breathe, let some of that moisture out so that there can be some airflow inside of the terrarium, and that usually helps an awful lot. Okay, I'm gonna plant these up. I mentioned before, I'm trying to keep the apothecary vases, jars, a little bit more simple because I have multiples of them. They're all going to be together, and I think if they're all jam-packed full of plants, it's just going to look a little bit odd and chaotic. And if you overfill these little terrariums, then you're much more likely to have fungal and bacterial issues and mold and whatnot. Terrariums are kind of like fish tanks. Usually the bigger the better, less maintenance. These little ones can be a little bit more tricky. And in this one, I'm just going to use another one of these super pixie Syngoniums. I like them a lot. I have so many of them. I think they make the most sense together. And that might be about it for this one. These being so small, these apothecary jars, I think that it's just a good idea to keep something in them that stays small. A lot of plants that go into terrariums will outgrow them. It can be hard finding like actual super dwarf plants that will stay really, really small for the terrariums, at least in my experience through my local nurseries. I don't find them that often. This is one, the super dwarf, only gets like 6 inches tall at the max. It will spread and need to be pulled and divided and whatnot over time, but for the most part, it could stay in here for a very long time. And you may notice, it's kind of hard to tell, but I did plant it at a slight elevation because I have a little bit of moss left, not as much as I wish I had. It's like 9 degrees outside Fahrenheit, so I'm not gonna be able to collect moss for a little while. So I need to stretch this out and make it last as long as I possibly can. But I want to use a whole bunch of it in here. I want to kind of line just a very gentle slope. It's not in focus. You get what I'm saying, though. I'm just going to put enough in there to line it up. There can be some empty patches. The moss will grow. That's the whole point of it being in there, is want to watch it grow. Slightly packing that down. I know the focus is really bad. It's hard filming through glass. I'm sorry. See, a little bit better in there. There's a slight elevation, and I'm just very lightly tapping this down. You may notice that I never, when I work with a terrarium, I'm never packing the soil down hard. I never go in and push it in firmly, and that's because we want some air to be able to flow in that soil. That's the whole point of having a light, fluffy substrate, is so that oxygen can get down in there. These glass containers, they don't really breathe very well. Like, pretty much at all, right? So if it's pushed down, you pack that down too much, it's not going to work out well for the roots of the plant. Ideally though, if the soil's been prepared properly and it's the right kind of mix, it really shouldn't clump up very much at all. It should spring right back. And I'm just using a water bottle here with a decent stream on it to kind of get the sides down, get some of that soil, get that loose substrate knocked off the sides there. Only using just barely enough water so that it kind of gets down there into the base. All right, so that's mounded up now. It looks much more mounded in person than it does right here, but there is a good slope there. Like I said, just wanted to keep this one very clean, very simple. I didn't want to get too complicated with it. So just some moss, Syngonium, that's it, done. But this one, yeah, I'm gonna throw a few more things in this one. Has a lot more girth to it. I can do a lot more with this. I always like to think a little bit about the hardscaping with the other one. It's just moss, nothing complicated. I didn't need to put any rocks in there with it. I think it looks best just moss and plant. But in this one, I would like to have some sort of stone. Just something to kind of balance things out a little bit. I like to make sure to use rocks or stones that have a lot of character to them. Different angles, different divots and whatnot. So this one should be just fine. I do have to be sure not to pour water directly over this rock because it's from an old saltwater tank that's going to buffer the pH kind of high. The peat that's in the substrate mix might combat that. I don't know. Kind of rolling the dice with this one a little bit, which I'm okay with, and I don't want this to be centered either because things in nature are rarely symmetrical or centered. They also will rarely contain the colors and the types of plants I'm going to be using, but you get my point. There we go. I think I like it like that. That looks good. And then as far as the plants are concerned, I have this pink Syngonium here that is just beautiful. Look at that foliage. Isn't it pretty? Kind of pulling this forward a little bit because I want to make sure it does have some room to grow. It's not one of the super dwarf varieties. It actually wasn't labeled at all, so I don't know for sure what type of Syngonium is. It just said pink arrowhead plant. My guess is it's the neon pink, which still doesn't get huge, but it's going to be kind of big for this. Then in the foreground, I have a fern here that also not labeled. Well, it was labeled as a button fern. I don't know if it is a button fern because it doesn't look like a button fern to me. That could just be because it's a little baby and hasn't taken on its grown characteristics yet. It's kind of hard to say. And I actually think I'm going to move this forward because I have a different fern that I'd like to put in the back next to that Syngonium. So that way the height will kind of balance out a little bit. And I also, there's still room for more soil in here. I made sure not to put too much in at one time. That way, when it's time to fill back in around the plants, I'm not making a huge mess just throwing soil all over the place in here. I can just lightly set it down and push it in gently around the base of the plants. And one more fern. And that's it. Easy and simple. They're both different. They're going to have different levels of care. This one over here that has the Syngonium in it, this terrarium is going to be a low maintenance terrarium. One little plant that I know is going to stay small enough to keep inside of here, it will spread and require some pruning, but it's not going to grow up too high vertically. Whereas over here, it's a little bit different. See, these are more mystery plants inside of this one. The fern that's in the back, it was labeled as a dwarf tongue fern. I don't think it is. It doesn't look like one to me. Maybe it is, though. I don't know. What I do know is that it looks like a very vigorous grower. So what chances are, not going to be able to stay in there forever. Same thing over here with the Syngonium. Now this, I don't think this is going to get bigger than 8 to 10 inches. That's still pretty big for something this size. And I don't even know what kind of fern this is. I don't think it was labeled properly, and I don't like to make guesses on things that don't have labels on them. I have ideas as to what it might be, but I don't want to say for sure. The smaller the terrarium, the higher the maintenance. That's just generally the way it goes. This is very small, little plant, little maintenance. This one is also small, but these plants that are in here, probably going to require some upkeep, some pruning in order to keep things in check. And eventually I may even have to go in and pull something out, and that's okay. It's all right to do that. These are teeny tiny little bitty things. It's not a great big huge vivarium or paludarium, something like that. It made sense to me to use this particular, whatever, I think this was a candle holder actually, to use this for the plants that have more of a mystery size to them, because it has a nice big opening for me to get my hands in and work with them should I need to do pruning, which I'm pretty sure I'm going to need to do. But the apothecary jar, just quick, easy, good times. Not much to it. Sometimes when a terrarium's new, I hesitate to keep the lid on it for too long if it's going to be a closed system terrarium. This one, having moss in it, I'm going to be extra cautious because moss shocks very easily. It's used to being in a consistently moist environment, and the terrarium should be consistently moist. But when a terrarium is new, they tend to be excessively moist, and that's when you have issues with the mold and whatnot. So I really only want to see condensation in here at nighttime. That's being caused from the transpiration from the plant releasing the vapor. All that water kind of sweating out of the foliage, sticking to the sides. That's okay at nighttime. And then it will still be there in the morning. That's okay too. But if it's there all day long, then I'll just take the lid off and let it dry out. If I notice in the midday, I'd say like anytime really, probably past noon to 1 o'clock in the afternoon, if it's still very, very moist inside of there, lots of condensation, then I probably need to pull the lid off and let it dry. Sometimes that's just normal the first few days that you have a terrarium. Whereas this one right here has an open top, so probably not going to be as much of an issue. I do think though I'm going to find one of those glass balls, one of those orbs that like people put in bowls on there, like, you know, a big glass decorative ball. I think that one of those would seal this up just fine. It wouldn't be a perfect seal, but that's okay. None of these are a perfect seal. Technically, something being airtight means it's impermeable. It's not really the case with either one of these. So they're going to be closed terrariums, but not really. There can be a little bit of air exchange up here in the top, and then this one, there's lots of air exchange, which is fine in the beginning. Particularly in this one because I didn't put any moss in here. I didn't put any moss in this one just because, well, I mentioned before, I'm getting low on moss, and I think that this would actually look really nice with some sort of elaborate stick in it instead of the rock. So I just kind of wanted to leave my options a little bit more open. And if I'm going to have to do maintenance, if I'm going to have to do a lot of pruning on these ferns or the Syngonium, whatever the heck that fern is, then I don't want to be tearing the moss up all the time to do that. So when I find a branch or a stick that I like to go in there, I'll drop that inside in place of this big stone right here, and then I'll probably put some gravel down, something like that. And that's it for today's Terrarium Tuesday. Talked about the soil, easy versus complicated, low maintenance, high maintenance, that sort of thing. I do want to go into more of the bioactive aspects of things, save that for another video. Each video I kind of want to go a little bit further in depth into a different aspect of a terrarium. That way it's just not like all in one thing. It can be a little bit more laid back, throw them together, talk about plants and look at plants, just having a good time. And these aren't all going to be inside of jars and vases and whatnot. I do have some larger things lined up that I want to do. We'll get to that more towards the end. I want to work my way up to that. And I may end up even pulling some plants out of ones I've already done to use in the bigger ones and swapping things out and playing with them over the next few weeks. And then kind of at the end of it all, get to go back and look at how everything's done over the last like 6 weeks or so, however long this goes on for. All right, comment down below. What are some things you've been doing with your terrariums? Tips, tricks, suggestions, always welcome. Put them down there. The more people talk, the more we can all learn together. I have all my social media linked down below in the description. I use Instagram more than anything else. And of course, all that YouTube stuff. You can give the video a like. That's great for the channel. I do appreciate it. Pardon my squeaky tripod. And subscribe as well and hit that notification bell. That way you know when new videos come out. Hope everybody's doing well, having a great day and a great life, and everything just going beautifully for you. I meant it when I said comment down below. It helps give me ideas of the things I need to talk about in these videos, things I need to address, common questions. The mold was a big one, so don't be shy. No reason to be shy here. What did they say? No such thing as a dumb question, or the only dumb questions are the one that you don't ask. I don't really believe that. There is such a thing as stupid questions. Don't worry, I won't tell you if it's a stupid question. It'll be between us. It's okay. I'm kidding, of course. Kind of. All right, like I said, hope everybody's doing well. And as always, and most importantly, everybody, keep on growing. Bye bye.